Copy protection. It's a topic that's near and dear to my heart, and one you all seem to enjoy. So allow me to take you on another trip down memory lane, but this time to the 80s and the time of 16-bit home computers, CRT monitors, and floppy disks, and discuss one of the most innovative forms of copy protection that was ever invented. In 1987, the battle between the Atari ST and the Commodore Amiga for supremacy in the household was at its peak, with each company trading blows with each other in a duel to the death. This was truly a classic era in video games, with many original franchises and arcade ports being developed for both systems. Innovation was off the charts, and it was an awesome time to be a gamer. Both the Atari ST and the Commodore Amiga at its core used the Motorola 68000 CPU, and both utilized 3.5-inch floppy disk drives. Games would come on one or more floppy disks, and there would be the inevitable disk swapping in order to play through the game, with some games even coming on as much as 12 floppy disks to play. Software piracy was also rampant on both machines. If you were a part of this era, you probably owned at least a few copied games or discs. There was a massive amount of copying that was going on. Everything from schoolyard swapping of discs to fully fledged bootlegging with replica boxes and disc labels. Piracy was a huge problem for software publishers back then, and of course came up with different ways to attempt to mitigate it as best as they could. The earliest forms of copy protection on the Atari ST and Amiga was simple. It was based on the manual protection. In other words, the manual that came with the game, with a simple lookup of a word on a page. There was nothing stopping you from duplicating the game, and if you had access to a photocopier, you could easily replicate the manual. This was pretty simple to defeat. It was also trivial for hackers to patch these checks out of the game. By simply locating the code that jumps to the subroutine that handles the manual check, it can be easily patched out, or the manual check itself always returns true, so you could enter any word and proceed. There was also the code wheel protection. This was popular on the Goldbox Advanced Dungeons & Dragons games, as well as LucasArts adventure titles like The Secret of Monkey Island. The code wheel was a different take on the manual protection method. But the code wheel had many combinations of results and made duplication tricky. But of course, if you were willing, you could just take apart the code wheel and photocopy each piece of it. The protection was also very easily patched by hackers, usually in a matter of hours after the game had come out. Software publishers knew that in order to mitigate copying of their games, they'd need to get more creative, and soon, disk-based protection mechanisms were commonplace. In general, disk copy protection is to apply some form of non-standard method to the master disk which will stop a disk copier from either reading the disk or making a backup of it. Most Amiga and Atari ST games from this era have this protection method installed. For example, if I attempt to read this disk in my Amiga, it won't even read it, and if I try to make a backup of it, it fails with errors. This type of behavior with original disks is normal. There were many different variants of disk copy protection, with one of the most popular known as CopyLock. Developed by Rob Northern, it was used in both the Amiga and ST, with hundreds of games containing this protection, with the first CopyLock game being released in 1987. Before we talk about this method, let's do a quick primer on a typical floppy disk that would be used in a Commodore Amiga or Atari ST. A 3.5-inch floppy disk is a circular piece of magnetic media that is double-sided. A double-sided floppy disk contains up to 880 kilobytes worth of data. A track is a circular path around the disk, and on both the Atari ST and the Amiga, there are 40 tracks per side. Each track is then divided into smaller blocks known as sectors, which are 512 bytes in size. The Amiga comes with 11 sectors per track as standard, and the Atari ST uses 9 sectors per track. A CopyLock protected floppy disk contains one long track that's not broken into sectors at all. This track is known as the CopyLock serial or verification track. Both the Amiga and ST have quite sophisticated disk controllers. The Amiga actually uses its custom chips and DMA to handle disk I/O. The CopyLock serial track can be easily read on an Amiga or ST floppy disk drive, but it cannot be written easily without very expensive floppy drive mastering equipment. Each game protected by CopyLock has code that can read and decode the CopyLock serial track. The encrypted code then verifies that the disc has the correct serial key, which is uniquely generated for each game. If this check is passed, then the game loads successfully. CopyLock stopped the casual copying of games, but cracking groups had skilled coders and crackers that knew 68000 assembly and the intricate details of both the Amiga and Atari ST floppy drive controllers and were able to easily defeat this protection. In fact, most CopyLock games were cracked in a matter of hours and released on bulletin boards to be spread worldwide, in some instances even before the game was on store shelves in some parts of the world.
So the best forms of copy protection, at least from the developer's standpoint, are the ones where it doesn't seem like anything has gone wrong. In other words, everything seems to be normal, but then all of a sudden, maybe a few hours into the game, some weird quirks and issues start to crop up, and you're not really sure if it's part of the game, or maybe the code isn't the best and it needs a patch. You're not really sure if it's something that was caused by the crack of the game itself, or if it was part of the game. Now, this particular thing was made famous by Spyro the Dragon on the original PlayStation. When you played a backup copy of Spyro the Dragon, you would start to get some weird behavior and some weirdness in the game. And it would basically tell you that you were playing a pirated copy of the game. But it still would let you play through the game, or so it seemed. But it continued to a point where the game itself just got so annoying and so unplayable that it was obvious that the game would not continue, or you couldn't finish the game. And the other big one that I'm thinking about is on the PC, known as the fade copy protection. This was very similar in that it would start out quite normal, but over time, as you continue to play through the game that had fade copy protection, it would render the game eventually unplayable.
In 1987, a company known as Faster Than Light released a game that would be later known as one of the most influential and important games ever made. Known as Dungeon Master, it was a four-player real-time dungeon crawler and was a smash hit on the Atari ST and Amiga. And it went on to become the best-selling Atari ST game ever. It's also seen ports to the Sharp X68000, FM Towns, MS-DOS PCs, Apple IIgs, and even on the Super Nintendo.
Dungeon Master was released by FTL in 1987 and was one of the best games for the Atari ST and the Commodore Amiga. I remember back in the day when I owned an Amiga, I only had 512 kilobytes of RAM, and this game needed a 1 meg RAM expansion to play. And I remember I was so jealous and so unhappy that I didn't have enough RAM to play the game. But eventually I got a RAM upgrade and was able to play the game in its entirety and complete it. And it's one of the best, most atmospheric games I've ever played. It's a awesome dungeon crawler, one of the original dungeon crawlers which spawned an entire genre of games like Eye of the Beholder, Dungeon Hack, Ultima Underworld, and much, much more. Stonekeep comes to mind as well by Interplay. And this was the original game. It had no music whatsoever in the game, but it had some of the best atmospheric sound effects I'd ever heard. But there was another part of Dungeon Master that was as devious as the game itself, and that was the copy protection.
If we consider traditional copy protection, there's two approaches usually to defeat it, either by cracking the game and rendering the protection useless, or by somehow making a copy of the game with the protection intact so that the computer believes that you are playing an original disc. So let's talk about the Atari ST version of Dungeon Master, since it's the one that I have here and it's an original version of the game. But keep in mind, the Amiga uses the exact same copy protection. If you insert an original Dungeon Master disc into the drive, you can open it up, browse the files, make a copy of the disc, and everything just works. You can even launch and play the game. So, great job! We've copied the game and defeated the protection. But what protection even? It was a simple copy of the files from the disc, and at this point you probably think that I'm joking. But like I said, Dungeon Master has some of the most devious copy protection ever invented. So what exactly is going on? Remember how I said that the Atari ST floppy disk was formatted with 9 sectors per track? The Dungeon Master disk was formatted with 10 sectors per track. This would provide additional space on the disk, and the ST was perfectly capable of reading a disk that's formatted with 10 sectors. So this really wasn't a factor on the protection itself, rather than allowing the game to unfit entirely on a single floppy disk. On the first track, if we look at Sector 8, it's not actually labeled Sector 8, it's labeled Sector 247. The ST will read this sector as 247, but if you attempt to make a disc copy of the game, it's not capable of writing Sector 247. This is the copy protection of the game. The contents of this sector, labeled 247, are read if the disk is original, but any copies that are made would be rendered useless. This in itself isn't difficult to circumvent, and that's what hackers did. Dungeon Master quickly was cracked and released on bulletin boards like normal, but it was apparent that there was more at play here. Many people complained after a few minutes to a few hours of gameplay that they would experience weird behavior in the game. For example, using a throwing weapon would just be suspended in the air, or opening a door would do nothing. Others complained that it kept asking for the game disk to be reinserted into the drive, while some others were getting System Error 60 displayed on their screen. All these issues were a result of the copy protection of the game, which was far from being defeated. If we think about storage media like floppy disks, DVDs and tape drives, all digital data is stored as binary or as ones and zeros. On a DVD, a pit or an area where the laser has burned is the equivalent of a one, and a land is a zero. On a floppy disk, a one is if the write head has magnetized that area on the disk, or a zero if it's demagnetized. These ones and zeros form the contents of the storage media, and in this case, the Dungeon Master game disk on floppy disk. But what if there was a way to somehow write a bit on a disk that sometimes might read as a 1 or sometimes might read as a 0 in some indeterminate state? This is known as a fuzzy bit, and it lived on sector 7 of track 0 on the disk. Its value is never known. It's either a 1 or a 0 and can change with each read of the disk. The game would know that a backup or pirate copy was being played if the result from the fuzzy bit was always the same, but if the result switched around between a 1 or a 0, then the game would play just fine. This fuzzy bit protection was so clever, it kept hackers stumped for months. They weren't really sure what was going on, but eventually they cracked the protection by simply patching this copy protection check out of the game, or so they thought. The best way to beat a cracker at their own game is to convince them that they've won. FTL made sure that if a protection check failed, then nothing would happen. In other words, it would still allow the user to play through the game as normal, but after some amount of time, the game would start to freeze or display the symptoms mentioned before, like the frozen doors or the System Error 60. The crackers weren't even sure that their methods were working. On top of this, the protection check was littered throughout the game, over and over again, and you'd need to play through the entire game to be sure that every single check was identified and caught. In the end, there were as many as 6 different checks, with some of them living in data files, not even in the main executable code. So when the graphics data file would load from disk into memory, it might trigger a protection check there. No one really knew where all of them were, except for the developers. In the end, Dungeon Master didn't beat the pirates, but it kept them clueless for an entire year. The protection eventually was completely patched, but FTL had won the battle. All while Dungeon Master became a smash hit on the Atari ST and Amiga and sold many, many copies. The fuzzy bit protection worked and was some of the most well-crafted early forms of DRM in video game history. It's also worth noting that the Super NES version of the game was released by JVC in 1991. It was a good port of the game that retains the same mood and atmosphere of the original, and it also uses a DSP2 custom chip, which was used to convert the bitmap graphics from the Atari ST version to native format on the Super NES. The DSP2 had little to no documentation available, and it was impossible to dump without decapping the chip. Without the DSP2, the game was unplayable. And in 2003, 12 years after the launch of the game, DSP2 emulation was added to the emulator. And finally, Dungeon Master was playable on emulation. Before this, this game was not playable on any Super NES system, and it's unknown if FTL was involved in the development of the DSP2, with Dungeon Master being the only game to ever use it. But in the end, Dungeon Master will go down in history as one of the greats that beat the pirates at their own game.
So there you have it, guys. That's the story of the copy protection of Dungeon Master on the Atari ST and the Amiga. The game itself, as mentioned, was a fantastic game, and it eluded hackers for about a year before it was finally cracked completely 100%. But in the relative terms, one whole year is an absolute lifetime, considering that games were usually cracked in a matter of hours. So FTL managed to hold the pirates at bay, no pun intended, and the company FTL or Faster Than Light came to the table with one of the most devious and clever copy protection mechanisms ever released in video game history. Well guys, let me know what you thought about this video in the comments below. It's a fascinating topic talking about floppy-based copy protection and something that I've been meaning to do considering we've done a lot of disk-based copy protection systems for many different systems. And I thought that would be very interesting to go back a little further and talk about the origins of some of this stuff, because some of this stuff goes way back to the 70s and there are lots more stories that I want to talk about when it comes to copy protection mechanisms across different systems and different types of storage media. Well guys, thank you so much for watching this video. I hope you enjoyed it. If you liked this video, you know what to do. Give me a thumbs up, and as always, don't forget to like and subscribe, and I'll catch you guys in the next video. Bye for now.